please have a roll call.
No, I'm.
Here.
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 Could you please stand for the flag?
The flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I know, you have to understand, it's not two boys. That's why I'm walking, so that's what's going on. We got some presentations tonight. This is so exciting, so I'm going to turn them over to Mr. Otto.
Yes, thank you. Each month, we recognize a school and do a school spotlight. And this month, we're excited to have Trey Vine here. Hi, guys. You all excited?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. All right, super. Well, we're excited to see you. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to our principal, Lisa Walk.
Thanks for all coming, everyone coming out to see the phonics dance tonight. I know that's why you're all here. So, anyway, we like to believe that. As you walk the halls of any elementary school in Beavercreek, and probably many across the state of Ohio, you will see students doing the phonics dance. And I have a feeling that a lot of you do not know exactly what that is. And we didn't know if board members had seen it or participated in it. So we wanted to share that with all of you. So I'm going to turn over to Mrs. Carol Lakovich. She is a second grade teacher at Trey Vine. She's a phenomenal teacher. And I was in her room doing her observation, and students were doing this. And I thought, there's our board meeting presentation. So the kids are wonderful. They're awesome kids anyway, but they're going to do a great job.
Thank you everyone for coming. Phonics dance is something that we do daily, so it's a repetitious chant that we do every single day. We start off with the alphabet chant, which we created on a board for you, looks like it for classroom, and then that is the exact phonics dance board that we use that kind of has all the digraphs, diphthongs, things that you really don't need to know about unless you're going dealing with, if you're going to be like a linguistic major, but these young children need these parts to be able to word attack. So Mr. Kamen, give us a try. Carol, right? Okay. How we do this is every single day we look at our board, we say this chant, we dance to it, and then we also refer to it a lot in our reading. We've got these hunks and chunks on the board, like I said, and then we also do worksheets that consist of these hunks and chunks, and we talk about it to support both decoding, which is what we do when we read, and encoding, which is a fancy word for how we spell. I think I skipped the content standards. Yeah. These are a lot of specific core content standards, but basically what it is these humps and chunks and learning about short and long vowel sounds just supports that foundation of reading skills, the decoding and encoding skill. And why we use it, it's fun, it gets the children moving, they interact. Again, it's something that we do daily. And it's super easy to get into the curriculum. So every single day we do this chant right after our calendar routine. We're able to refer back to it. The visuals are always up. So it's easy and it ties right into what we need to be learning. Here are some of our very own kids in action. So that's kind of what it looks like when you're not at a school board meeting. We are in a second grade classroom. And we want to thank everyone for coming to the Board of Education. Thank you for letting these young ones here and their parents and presenting to you. And thank you families for coming, especially with you guys, are you ready? Thank you. We'll do the ABC check first, okay? Just like you on our own. And you will see a sign. Everybody Counts is a program that recognizes children with disabilities. And in second grade, it's... All right, friends, we got to make sure that we're seeing it, though. So you will see us do sign language to go along with that, because in second grade our Everybody Counts program outlines children with hearing impairments, so we know sign language goes with it too.
All right, let's go.
A, Abby,
A.
Or
A.
Got
B, baby, bug.
B, O said to A, oh, I love you.
And A said absolutely nothing.
So when you see O, A, say up.
When you see O, A, say up.
O, W, oh. Sometimes you say ow, and sometimes you say oh at the end of a word. Sometimes you say ow, and sometimes you say
oh at the end of a word.
A, Y, A.
Do you want to play? Swish, squawk, hooray!
A said, I, hey, I
want to have my way.
I say A today.
So when you see A, I say A. When you see A, I say A.
Program for at least 3 years and just didn't know how or who to get it started. I said, well, good start. And so began to contact other organizations in Beavercreek and began to make awareness. And, you know, we talked to the school district as far as which school do we start in. And they let us know that, where we would begin. But we also knew that we could not begin in one school unless we could support our whole year. And, you know, the statistics were not real clear about exactly how many students or what the percentage of the students were that were on, even on free and reduced meals, that would give us some kind of an idea. So, but anyway, we began to make awareness, and I had contacted all the churches in the area saying, hey, you want to help me get this started? Just partly for the lack of knowing where to get started. And seven churches, representatives from their churches, met with me, and we began to work out the details and making awareness in the community. And within, that was in August, and then in September, we had enough to support one school for a whole year. So we started in that school, we just continued to make awareness. Christmas time, we added two more schools. By the end of that school year, we had added all six of our elementary and our preschool. And we were just in shock. But it wasn't just us that were in shock, Beavercreek was in shock as well. But they were extremely supportive. And so now that we, you know, that was clear back in 2010, now looking in 2016, it's still a big need. It doesn't get smaller, it just gets bigger, more awareness. How the kids get on the program is not by qualifying for anything. The counselors send out information at the beginning of the year, you know, when you get that big stack of papers. Most of the time, ours goes out about 2 weeks after that because they don't want the paper to get lost in all the papers that they need. And then the parents just respond back by sending the paper back to the counselor. So we never come in contact with these families unless a counselor asks us to. And when a counselor asks us to, it's usually something that's pretty drastic. But at the same time, we also know that these are real legitimate problems because these are the counselors have been trying to help these families, the teachers, the principals, all of them have been involved. So we really never come in contact with these children other than unless there's a special need that, or a special situation that a family needs help with. But I wanted to share a story about a little second grade girl. She was there, her and her mom were new to our district, and she would go through the lunch line, and when she went through that lunch line, she would ask the lunch lady for a Ziploc bag. And so the lunch lady would keep an eye on her, just kind of curious, and she noticed that she would eat a little bit of her lunch, put the rest of it in the Ziploc bag. So about the third day this happened, the lunch lady approached her and said, so why do you not eat all your lunch here? Why do you put it in the Ziploc and take home? Well, the little girl, second grader, was very shy, very embarrassed, and she looked at the lunch lady and she said, if I don't take my lunch home, my mom and I will not have dinner tonight. So she was not part of Beavercreek at the time, so the lunch lady got her connected with the counselor who got her connected with us, and then we actually were able to meet this family. It's a great mom, young mom, in school, has a part-time job, works full-time when she can, but trying to better herself and just cannot make ends meet. And so we get a lot of those. A lot of our situations are grandparents and great-grandparents raising their grandkids. It's amazing how many of our Beavercreek grandparents are raising grandkids. And a lot of grandparents, which is more great-grandparents, they cannot get assistance if they own a home. Because you could sell that home and live out of your car. But you could feed your kids if you're living out of your car. So they are not able to get the assistance they need a lot of times to help raise these grandkids. So anybody can be on this program. We never check whether or not they're on free or reduced, nothing. Anybody and everybody can be a part of it. The one thing that we do get back is when a family goes through a tough time, we had a family a couple years ago who both parents lose their job at the same time. They eventually lose their home because they were not able to get jobs quick enough. So now we have three of our kids in our schools who don't have a home, parents aren't working. So we were able to, working with the city, get them into a home temporarily, and about 3 months later, both parents were able to get jobs and now are volunteers for Beavercreek. Very supportive, but it was at a time when they needed needs. So we give that back and forth. We get kids on, our numbers change up and down all the time based on the, you know, the family's situations. So anyway, it's a sad situation, but our city of Beaver Creek has been so good at taking on and being responsible for their families. This is a, you know, they use Feed the Creek as a tool. It's not Feed the Creek's problem. They're just there in order to help support these families, help support our school and the community as well. So anyway, any questions? Quick questions? I know we've got lots going on tonight. All right, well, thank you very much. And if you ever want to get involved, you know, let us know. Thank you.
Our next presentation is recognition of retirement. So with that, I'll turn it over to Mr. Van Chu.
Thank you, Mr. Vaughn. Appreciate that, board. It's good to see you this evening. I love this part of my job, being able to recognize individuals who serve our community and our schools as they transition to another part of their life in retirement. And this month, we have three individuals who have provided us with notification of retirement. And they will have their last paid day here with the Beavercreek City Schools this month. And we begin their retirement effective January 1st. So how this works for those of the three of you that are sitting out there wondering what's going to happen next, I'm going to ask all three of you to come up in just a moment. And when you serve notification to the board of your retirement, the board acts on that and accepts that notification. And in doing so, they adopt a resolution, and I'll read that resolution to you this evening. You'll each get a copy of that resolution, a plaque thanking you for your service to Beaver Creek City Schools, and an athletic or events pass that'll allow you to come to Beaver Creek City Schools, any events that you want from now until forever, to enjoy the things that our students do and the things that they engage in. I will also ask your supervisor or supervisors to come up and say a few kind words about you and your service. So at this time, I would like to invite Ms. Pandy Booz, Ms. Shelley Packman, and Mr. Todd Mendenhall. You guys come on up here and stand up here in the front. At the board meeting, when you submitted your letter of resignation for the purpose of retirement, this resolution was adopted. At the board meeting, Board of Education, Beaver Creek, so I'll start again. At the meeting of the Beaver Creek Board of Education held, and insert the date you served your notification, the following resolution was adopted. Whereas the Beaver Creek Board of Education has received notification of the retirement of Mr. Richard Todd Mendenhall, Ms. Pandora, Andy Booz, and Michelle Shelley Patton. And whereas the board wishes to publicly recognize Mr. Mendenhall for his 25 years of service to Beaver Creek City Schools, Ms. Booz for her 23 years of service to Beaver Creek City Schools, and Ms. Packman for her 29 years of service to Beaver Creek City Schools. Whereas through their efforts, the quality of support rendered to our students, staff, and administration, and the performance of the school's mission has been greatly enhanced. And whereas these individuals leave an outstanding professional and personal record which will serve as an exemplary model for all of us to follow. And whereas their presence, influence, and contribution have helped to make our schools a better place, be it resolved that the Beaver Creek Board of Education hereby accept with regret the retirement resignation of Todd Mendenhall, Pandy Booz, and Shelley Packman, and publicly expresses to them their sincere appreciation for your outstanding career in our schools. We wish you health, happiness, and a long, active, contented retirement. So at this time, I would like to ask Mr. Mike Schumann to come forward. And Shelley, this is for you.
Thank you. My name is Mike Schumann. I'm the Director of Technology for Beaver Creek City Schools. I've
had the pleasure of working with Shelley for the 9.5 years that I've been here. I've only been her supervisor for the last 5. It's been a pleasure for those 5 years, and I have a few things to say for her. You know, her recent position is registrar in the technology department secretary. And as registrar, I often refer to her as the face of Beavercreek. And I don't think we could have a more perfect face of Beavercreek. She is absolutely the prototypical people person. If you meet her, she will remember you, and she'll make you feel welcome. Everybody that I know talk about Shelley talks in a positive way. Shelley has a secret superpower. I've noticed over the years she has a sixth sense. And you know, maybe I'm not so cool, but I call her spider sense. And she seems to know when people need help. And Shelley is that person that if you need help, she will always be there. Now, she has helped me as the department secretary and as a friend for a long time now. She'll be missed in that role, but it's a tribute to her and to her parents. I see her dad in the audience. I hear about her parents all the time, and her husband, Margaret, you know, she's just that person that everybody loves. So, she truly wants to help everyone, and she seems to know everyone. When new people come in the district and they start talking about somebody, I've said, if you want to know, ask Shelley, she probably knows that person right there. That's an awesome thing. It's a great service to the entire community of Beaver Creek. That's one of the reasons we love you so much. And we will miss you, but I know you, along with wanting to help people, you like to be around people. So I look forward to when you come back and have lunch with us. It would have been a pleasure.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I know you're probably tonight because he told me I could talk 2 to 5 minutes. And I know I'd have absolutely no problem talking about good things you've done with this district for 2 to 5 minutes. We greatly appreciate everything you've done. I know when I came here 9 years ago, the role you were serving with the district was as the most senior person in our grounds department. Can't think of one time that I ever was worried about would the snow be moved, would the parking lots be cleaned, would the yards be mowed. Absolutely fantastic work the entire time that you served with me. So,
thank you.
I consider you a friend. I hope that as you go through, you'll come back and see us. And I'm going to turn it over to Dan, and he's going to talk about all the great things that the Valley family has to say about you.
Thank you.
You know, everything that Todd just said is very true. I had the honor or the privilege to work with Todd the last couple of years at Valley Elementary. We were very lucky for him to come in as our head custodian for the last couple of years. He made a very, very significant impact right away, just with, his professionalism, getting everything done, really helping to transition the building for the future. So we're very, very appreciative of that. The other thing that I got to see was his interaction with the kids. When we were getting close to the day, the teachers were telling the kids that he wasn't going to be here anymore, and they just cried. He was only here, in the Valley for a couple of years, but, had a profound impact on him. So, Tom, it was an honor.
Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to invite Ms. Joelle Mangan up to say a few words about Candy Boo's but I'm going to say a couple words first. I had the distinct pleasure and opportunity, Andy, to work with you for 6 years at Fairbrook Elementary School on a daily basis, and it's been an honor to be a part of your life and to be able to work with you. We giggled, we smiled, we laughed, we told jokes, and we even cried together. And I do appreciate the time that we were able to spend together, and I wish you all the best.
I wrote it down because I was afraid, with Mandy especially, I was afraid I would get too emotional, I wouldn't be able to think clearly. So I just wrote down a few things. Mrs. Pinky Boots began her career at Fairbrook Elementary School in the fall of 1981 when her oldest son Steve began kindergarten at Fairbrook. So she has been there a long time, right? She was a very active member of our Fairbrook PTO and did many different jobs there, it's my understanding. She assisted in the building in various ways and got to know all of the staff and students. And so therefore, when the office assistant position became available, Mrs. Beaver approached her about taking that position so she could at least get paid to be there every day. So since that time, she has been an invaluable office assistant for four principals, Linda Beaver, Darren Schwederman, Terry Noe, and Rose Noe, just myself. When I was asked to be the Fairbrook principal, and I am not kidding when I say this, when I was asked to be the Fairbrook principal, the first question I said was, is Kathy Young from Handy Booth still going to be there? And I was told yes, and I said, okay, they won't let me fail. I'll do it. So sure enough, that's exactly what happened. They were there every step of the way. And so when Candy had the accident this fall and wasn't able to come back, I was fairly certain I needed to call the superintendent and ask him to delay school for a period of time. I wasn't sure whether Kathy was going to come back the next day or not. I wasn't sure if I knew how to open a building without Candy. And I can't imagine even the next 4 or 5 months without Candy. But I want you to have a great time in retirement. I want you to enjoy your family because you really deserve it. You've been our favorite family for a long, long time, and we deserve your time now.
So, congratulations.
Included
one of the most recent ones, regarding the regional STEM Jet initiative. And we said at the previous meeting that we'd come back at a later time with more specifics and details for all of you, so that, and for the public, so that you would know where this initiative really is at this point. And so what I'd like to do is give you a brief history of really since Paul and myself and Mr. Thompson came on board July 2016 through the present. And as you can see on the screen, the bullet points there, just have several different items that have happened in this last 6 months or so, including the following. The SHP Lead Design provided us a proposal that included some drawings, plans, as well as anticipated costs to place the jet on Beavercreek School's property, including the interior and exterior renovations, so that we can occupy that as a facility, the district facility. We also put a request for proposals out there to physically move the jet from the International Airport to Beavercreek High School, and we received two proposals from that request. We'll share the result of that in just a minute. Our team did a logistical analysis of STEM jet usage, and what I mean by that is that, you know, the spirit of the grant is the K-12 initiative, so we had to look at what were the realistic possibilities to be able to move all of our students from their locations in their buildings each day from their buildings out to the jet throughout the course of the year. And so that took some time to figure out what that really could look like, and that has been completed. We also did a curriculum outline that was rooted in K-12 Ohio learning standards, and seeing what kind of instruction could take place in the classrooms related to the jet. We did an analysis of curriculum development that applies, as well as the professional development needs, all that located within the grant funds themselves, and completed a final estimation of total costs to support the STEM jet within the schools for the next 5 years. I'd like to turn it over to Mrs. Sizemore at this point. She is our straight A grant coordinator and has a wealth of knowledge on all of our grants, but for this one in particular, I'd like to take you through grant language as well as compliance and other things as well. So, Mrs. Sizemore.
As Mr. Otten said, we were awarded the straight A grant, which was worth $984,000. The expectations outlined within the grant of what we are bound to as a part of the acceptance of that money is to move and remodel the jet into a STEM learning environment, to create a publicly available K-12 aerospace curriculum program that includes two lessons per grade level that are connected to the Ohio science standards, and to have virtual lessons accessible via the web so students across the state or across outside of the state who wanted to learn about this environment could access it without having to physically come on site. All of those expectations have to be accomplished by August of 2017 as a part of the grant timeline. So that's a part of the straight A process itself. The budget within that grant of where the $984,000 are allotted, we had $599,000 set aside to the creation of the learning environment. That included the move, the remodel, preparing the concrete pad, heating and air conditioning, those types of things. Those were based on some very early verbal estimates. Instructional equipment, $100,000 for that, $100,000 towards the development and writing of the actual curriculum, $85,000 to go towards professional development, recognizing if we were going to be asking our teachers to be utilizing this, we need to be able to provide the necessary professional development to not ask them to do something without the preparation. $85,000 towards specific curriculum materials to have available within that learning environment so that we could actually do something there. And $15,000 towards the Wright State University evaluation services. That was a big piece that came out of the later versions of the straight A grants. They really wanted external evaluators so that they could have more validity placed on grants as they awarded more and more straight A grants. So that was one of those expectations. So that's what came to that $984,000. The compliance pieces that go with this, of course, anytime the state offers out any money, they have strings attached. It has 5 years of sustainability after the grant year. So our current school year is considered our grant year, It is our planning year. It is also the year in which we have to expend the funds. Once we have done that, we have to uphold and continue with the grant for 5 years after that and sustain all costs associated with that grant project. It's a requirement that goes with all of our straight aid grants. Part of that then requires that documented evidence. Those of you who have been a part of the site reviews that we've had for our previous straight aid grants know it's excessive amounts of documentation that goes with that. We have to be able to upload those into the compliance center, the electronic compliance center of the state itself, and then have paper versions available for our site audits and reviews. And then we have 3 reporting windows where we have to upload information about every grant. So we've already actually started some of the compliance reporting for our current grants. We have a fall, a mid-year, and a spring on top of any site visits that they choose to do. And that's for each of our straight aid grants. This goes back to you, Mr.
So with all that as the background, one of the things that clearly we had to do this year was to start getting some information and start looking at the figures associated with making this happen and to analyze those costs. We really broke it down into really 3 parts. Initial costs, we had our ongoing personnel costs, and we had ongoing operational costs that we looked at. And full disclosure to that, there are some of these that are hard fact numbers as they were given as specifics within items that we had to find out. Those are our quotes per se. There are some of these that are estimations that there's really no way to know exactly what it would be, but we wanted to give a good faith estimation, so we had some numbers to work with. I wanted to share initial costs first, and this includes the relocation from the direct estimates from the bid process, as well as a written estimate from SHP on the development, construction, and remodeling code. We also looked at an estimation of security, including fencing, camera system, and security system for the project, as well as the curriculum. And it's important to understand here that underneath the curriculum, these were within grant fund amounts, so that all of that was designated within grant funds, as well as all of the relocation and those kind of things. But the bottom line is when you combine all of those, just the initial costs up front included $1.8 million, just to get the project underway for August of next year. Then we start looking at ongoing personnel costs, and you'll see that this is broken out into what the personnel requirement would be, a 1-year cost, as well as a 5-year cost. And important to look at the 5-year component of that, because as Mrs. Sizemore said, that this is a 5-year grant, and it has to be sustainable for the district within that 5 years. And so when we look at a teacher or instructor for being out in the jet on a regular basis for our students, that is a certified salary person here in the district as a teacher or instructor. So I won't read through all of these with all of the numbers, but we felt like the personnel side of this included our teacher, custodian, bus driver for a shuttle, administrator, secretarial, part-time services, supplemental contractors, as well as substitute teachers for our 6-12. So when our science teachers would be going with students to the JET, those classes in the middle schools would still be going. And so we would have to have subs in those classrooms. And again, you can see there that the dollar figures associated with that are getting estimations, but they are workable numbers based on what those estimations are for the 1-year to 5-year cost. Again, $1.1 and $1.2 million for 5 years worth of this timeline. And then we also had operational costs. And again, full disclosure here, there are some things about this that are purely estimations. But we looked at items such as curriculum materials. Some items that are, again, happening in K-12, where we have a number of different non-reusable materials that have to be replaced every year as part of the curriculum costs. Instructional materials replacements, bus costs, and operational mileage, as well as maintenance. The HVAC and electric for on-site usage within that facility, keeping in mind that there would be quite a bit of equipment located inside the jet that would have to be maintained at a relatively reasonable room temperature all year long, including in the sub-zero numbers we're looking at this week, as well as the plus 100s that we'll be seeing in summertime, because that equipment would be on board all the time. And then there's just routine and unexpected maintenance, and that just is an estimation. We have no idea what necessarily to expect because it is a unique project, but we had to put some sort of maintenance costs in there for the regular use of our facility. And again, this is, as an estimation, nearly $1 million. It's $937.7 in these figures, but again, there's a lot of estimations within that number. Here's a summary of these estimated expenses, including the three types of costs that we've talked about. The initial, the ongoing, and the operational, ongoing personnel and operation costs. And over the five-year period, we see nearly $3.9 million that we need to be expending to keep the project going. And again, the straight A grant funds, as was described previously, was $984,000. So when you take those expected use or expected costs and you look at the fund cost, you see about $2.9 million need from the district standpoint to put this project into play. And I have several different factors to consider, just as a, again, something for you to consider as you look at those numbers. None of the straight A funds that we currently have been expended. Once those funds are expended, even one penny of it, we are essentially kind of on the hook for the entire project. And if we are unable to complete the project in the way that it was laid out in the straight A grant, then the district would be responsible for repaying those straight A funds. So that is important to know that we've not used one penny of those funds at this point, as this study and analysis was being completed. It would also be important to know that because it is a five-year project, it would be very important to have the expected total costs in play and in place for us to use before we started using any of those funds. And so the entirety of that budget would really need to kind of be in hand for the district to utilize before we feel comfortable going forward with using any of those straight aid funds. And again, I put up here as well that when this project was first started, there was a commitment not to use public funds for any aspect of that project. And just to continue it, and I've mentioned this previously, it is a unique project. So while there are a lot of assumptions here and there's a complete unknowing of exactly what this is going to entail, we did do our best to give some good faith estimations of what we would expect to need to keep this project going over a five-year period. These five-year costs do not account for things such as inflation, increased personnel costs, as well as unforeseen operational increases. That includes anything and everything from bus fuel and transportation costs to electric and HVAC and all of those kinds of things that really are unforeseen. And then the estimates for replacement of instructional materials just include routine wear and tear. This in spirit has a lot of technology components to it, as well as other resources that would be used on an everyday basis by our students, which would be the plan, that would have some expected, a life expectancy of less than 5 years. And so those kind of things would need to be replaced over time. And while we wouldn't know specifically what that looks like, we have to account for the fact that those are would be kind of cost of doing business was expenses for us. So those would be not necessarily yearly replacements, but we have to plan on having some sort of yearly replacements for things like computers, hardware, and other equipment that would be a part of the curriculum and the construction materials for the project. And just additional items just to clarify, these figures that we came up with are strictly for Beavercreek City School students. Per the grant, we have partners at the Xenia City School as well as Green County Career Center that would be partner entities and have an expectation of having access to the data. An estimate for securing and moving engines to the Career Center, which was discussed at an earlier date, are not reflected in these figures and would not be something that the Beaver Creek City School would be responsible for. So it's important to remember that. And also, the transportation costs. When we put that in there, it reflected a shuttle bus payment, which means that we need to have transportation from all of our buildings to the site and back at least two times per day. But in many cases, as we know, we have students that have special needs, and those special needs include special transportation. So that factor was not put in play with these figures, although it is an expected expenditure if we were to go forward with this project, that we need to account for additional transportation costs that are not in these. These funds as we just described. So again, unknown student needs and population, but it's hard to project that, so we're not putting it in there, but it is something to consider as we move forward. And at this point, I'd like to turn it back over to Mr. Robin for his final.
comments regarding this project.
Thank you, Jason. Just a couple comments. When you look at those figures, those are staggering figures. And, you know, a couple pieces, straight A grant, I know that Mrs. Sizemore has already submitted our first round of compliance with the state. And as Jason had commented, the minute we start taking those, taking money from the straight A grant, we have to finish the project. So one of the things that we've always said is in order to take step one, you have to have step 10. You have to be able to have the revenue, the money that's generated to do that. So as we worked through this and we looked at those figures, from the seat that I sit in, I don't see us being able to proceed with this project. I think it's one of those, there's a lot of unknowns about the project. There's a lot of pieces that we may be high on some numbers, but we're probably low on other numbers. And you know, it's as we delved into the planning of this, the deeper we got, the muddier it became. And but with all that being said, what I'd like to share with the board is kind of what I see as our next step. So what I see as our next steps is we need to meet with ODD quickly, and probably set up a time after the new year. Sit down with them and talk to them about the straight A grant, because it would be our intent not to utilize that funding. Again, use it, you have to complete the project. And I applaud the board, first of all, for when they accepted the JET, that we said no tax dollars would be used on this project. And you know, that's a very bold statement, because some projects you can run away with money on. And so I applaud you for making that statement. At the same time, too, anything that we get into, this becomes an asset. So the JET sitting at Dayton International is the asset of Beavercreek City Schools. So we cannot allow it to continue to sit at Dayton International. We have to figure out what are we going to do with those, with the JET, and what are our next steps. So what I want to let the board know is we have started engaging with some of our partners, Green County Career Center, Wright State, and Clark State, to explore some other option with the JET. I can tell you that last week I had a meeting with Dave Deskins at Green County Career Center, and he has a very creative idea that he's working with a group of individuals. This would not be a Beavercreek JET, it would be the Green County Regional STEM JET. And so he would like to explore that as a possibility, and truthfully, it would be a resource that we could utilize around the entire Green County school system. So we can go around all the seven districts that he would remove. Well, he wouldn't remove them, we would remove them in the scrapping of them, but he would take ownership of those pieces, and they have volunteered that they will do the transport and transport. So that will be at no cost to Green County Career Center. It will not be a cost to us. So we do see pieces of this being able to truly help the kids in Green County, so we're excited about that. So, any other questions? Okay. And our last presentation is an update on changes to the 17-18 middle school schedule. Last week, we met with staff from the middle school at Poy and Ankeny to talk about the changes that we've been working on for next school year. Through that process, what we want to do with the board has received most of this information. What we want to do is go through the presentation that was shared with the staff at that time. And since that time, there's been a number, I know all of you have received a number of correspondences from staff with concerns. And I appreciate you forwarding those on to us. We have worked with those, and we would like to address those concerns as well with the board, and kind of tell you what we see as our next step. I know that there has been some question in regard to a vote, or and this is not an item that will come before the board for a vote. It doesn't require a vote, so I just want to let you know that as well. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Mr. Enix and give him an opportunity to share about the middle school schedule changes for next year.
Okay, thank you. Again, as Ms. Drotten stated, on Wednesday of last week, we went out to the buildings and shared the presentation that you are going to see here in just a few minutes. We'll try to keep this as abbreviated as possible, as I know that you are sort of aware of most of the information that you're going to see on the presentation slides, but I just wanted to make this an item to share with you and with the public as well. So with that, let's go ahead and get started. That really to start this out, it's really important to understand that scheduling is an all-year event at the middle school and high school level. We needed to have a plan developed to keep this process going year-long, and it really starts in September. When you analyze your current year schedule, you look from in that first semester to the needs assessment, revising course descriptions, course offerings, course of study updates, revising the program studies, and at the next board meeting, you will have run through the program studies to adopt and get ready for finalizing the registration process, which will begin in February. Students will be registering for courses in February into the March timeframe. And between March and April, our middle schools and high school will be completing the master schedule, with the finalized master schedule will be completed in May, which is not what happened this past year. On August 1st, I was sitting down with Mr. Kelly and some of his staff from Coy, and we were trying to finalize the master schedule on August 1st. And that is a really bad plan, to be very honest with you. So we committed at that point to a process and a schedule, a timeline, to complete the master schedule in a much more efficient manner. And so that really began our conversations with our middle school and our high school staff on creating a process that really works in terms of scheduling. There are some key items that I think that, you know, from a middle school perspective are important to keep in mind when you start working in any type of scheduling. There are obvious academic, physical, and social emotional growth concerns to consider. Exposure to a variety of courses and experience is an important part of the middle school experience. Preparing for high school requirements, student looking at their own interests, 21st century learning, and getting ready for the buzzword of college career readiness. That's important. Students at that age have varying levels of needs, and differentiating learning for those students based on those needs is important. And then it's important to understand that there are certain requirements that students are required to take during their time in middle school, and there are also only electives that are part of middle school experience that are experiencing for the first time and want to choose some of their own courses. And so these are all key objectives when thinking about middle school. The list here is just a combined, it's not an entirety list, but it's just some current practices that are happening. You know, at our middle schools, we have encore classes that are all electives, with many of those having repeated components in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. We block our language arts courses. We do not meet all of our state requirements. As you are aware, we adopt a resolution in fall to acknowledge the fact that we are not meeting the career tech requirements by the state, and we have to submit that to the state as a career tech waiver each year because we're not meeting the requirements. We do offer high school courses at the middle school level. It has been a practice to have late year course recommendations, which helps to exacerbate the problem of not being able to get a schedule completed in a timely manner. We have period and grade specific encore courses, required study hall for all students at the middle school level, individual plan as well as a PLC plan for all of our staff. There are core content staff, and those are blocked periods for 6th and 8th grade, which means they have those back to back. And then we have an inconsistent master scheduling process. And again, that was something right away we looked to address just from a big picture standpoint. So while there are many other current practices, these were just a few of the options that were looked at by a group that was really studying all of our middle school practices. I'd like to share some data with you. And this data is part of that analysis that takes place in September, where we are currently with our current year schedule. And I'd like to start off with looking at our core content class size data. And this was information pulled out of Dazzle, which is where all of our course information is located. And on the left-hand side, you see COI, and on the right-hand side, you see Ankeny, and what's next to those are average of 27 or over. And so to read this, if you're looking at Ankeny's column, in sixth grade, our honors language arts, math, honors math, and science all have average class sizes of 27 or higher. And so you can look at that list on both sides of COI and Ankeny, all the grade levels. And at the bottom, I want you to note that there are 11 courses in that list, and they're not designated, certainly, but there are 11 of them. those where there's an average class size of 29 or higher, and we have the highest average of 35 in one of our areas there. That was just, again, from a data analysis standpoint in September. And just to clarify, why we look at September is that when we start the school year, there's typically about a two-week window where class course offerings and student schedules change. Counselors are very busy those first couple weeks with either errors in course requests, or we need to balance numbers, or something happens to where our schedules change. And so we wait until September to look at this, because by that time, a lot of that change process during the first couple weeks has ceased. And so this is when we first started looking at not the first week of September. Just for some contrast, the next slide is similarly constructed, with Coy on the left and Hinkey on the right. In this case, it's the encore class size data. And as you can look at this, again, looking at it the same way, we'll look at Hinkey's sixth grade. Careers, 2D art, 3D art, design thinking, PE, fitness for life, all have average class sizes of 20 or less. And so you can look at that entire list, and all of these courses, again, on average, and they aren't averages, so there are some that don't fit within that, but on average are under 20 throughout the year. At the bottom of the screen, you'll see that nine of those, and we, again, purposefully not put which ones those were for this purpose presentation, nine of these courses have 13 students or under on average, with the lowest having an average class size of 6.8 for the year. So again, this is pure numbers coming out of our DASL reports on number of courses and how our sections are filled for this past school year, for this current school year. Another piece of information that was utilized at the very beginning of the school year, and even before the school year started, almost on a day-to-day basis, was looking at our elementary class sizes. And how to read this, this is where in the district we have an average class size at our elementaries, the grade levels where the average class size is 25 or higher at our elementary level. You'll note two kind of key points there. At Parkwood, our fourth grade students, our fourth grade classrooms have 30 per class. And at Trayline, our first grade, the first grade has 27 per class. And so these are numbers that are always difficult to work with to start the school year, because you have to make decisions for our students at the elementary level before the school year starts. It's really not a good practice to have a first grade kid start off first grade and be in the classrooms, and then, you know, a month later, we may have to increase staffing, which means that some students from every classroom that are tight with their first grade teacher already are split off to a new teacher. So these are critically important numbers to look at regularly. And, you know, certainly in that June, July, August time period, we can really start the school year. This is where we are as of right now. And I would also point out that Parkwood was not there to start the year. Enrollments that have continued to happen past the first of the school year has created this 30 per class situation that Parkwood has currently. Next piece of information was a plan time study, and at the 2015 negotiations, one of the items that came out of that was an agreement between the association and the district to take a look at the plan time differences between all of the different areas of the district, including our high school, middle school, and elementary staff. And I did share a document with you that has that information on it from that committee, showing lots of different subsets of our populations of staff and what that looks like in terms of a non-instructional time or plan time. And again, this was completed as a joint effort between members of the association and administration during the 2015-2016 school year using that year's data. At the bottom of the screen, you'll see what's, again, I'm going to say the approximations, you've seen the official data as I shared that with you, but high school staff, approximately 14% non-instructional, elementary, approximately 14%. There are subgroups of our special ed staff who are in approximately 5% non-instructional time, and our middle school staff at approximately 26% non-instructional time. Again, that was all data that was collected from last year and shared with me during my first week here in the year. I'd like to share a little bit about the timeline of events from August through now. In August, we finalized the master schedules at Coy and Hinkey, as I mentioned. Some of the first conversations I had with Mr. Kelly and Mr. Wren were centered around master scheduling concerns, and that was back in July. We put together our scheduling committee, and that included middle school, high school administrators, counselors, Mr. Schwederman, Ms. Diori, myself. We've got special ed supervisors involved with this, our curriculum been involved in different, from the department standpoint and conversation, all looking at scheduling practices and where we are with our middle school and high school scheduling. Building principals in all of those buildings began getting feedback from staff on the current schedule. The course analysis was completed. It's just going to share with you. And we also began a math course study process. During September through November, our scheduling, our district scheduling group continued to meet and discuss it. So now we have all of our scheduling folks that will be in the room and putting together a master schedule, having all been trained and all having the same content, the same vocabulary, and the same training on how most effectively put together schedules for their buildings. And that's an incredibly valuable training session. I've been through it myself in a previous position, and it's still to this day the best training I've ever had. So I'm thrilled that our administrators and counselors have been able to be a part of that process. I'm sorry. So that led us to several items here that we shared with the staff, and really addressing all of the needs that were presented as areas of concern. And encore and electives are currently quarter classes, and the decision was made to make that make those into semester or year-long courses, depending on what the courses were, for a variety of different reasons, including being able to go into depth with our students instead of a nine-week class for one semester, and not circulating through 3 years, so that students would not be faced with the decision of whether to schedule something for the third time or the second time after they're already taken it once. So that was one of the issues that was addressed, certainly an interest that was expressed very early on in this process from our middle schools. We looked at the required encore classes and having lack of options. And that was also a function of something that happened earlier, but kind of just on a philosophical basis, that we want our students to have good, well-rounded experiences when they're coming out of our middle schools. I think that as a committee and as a group, I think we would all understand that middle school has a time period of need to expose students to a lot of different experiences. And having required elective courses, as we will see here in just a few minutes, does provide every single Beavercreek City School student with the same elective courses that are not core content, but they're experiences that may generate interest in other things as they go throughout the rest of their high school career. So that was something that we thought was an important change to make from all electives, having kind of this consistency of students taking, but still having plenty of opportunity for electives. The third bullet there is Project Lead the Way, Green County Careers Center Partnership. Again, we addressed the issue earlier of us not meeting the career tech requirement as a district. So we talked with our partner with Green County Career Center to bring in courses that will meet those requirements, as well as an investment on their end to provide materials and resources that as an entity that will really help support our students. I'll be very excited to share that with you, and this will also be something that we share more in depth with the board meeting in January. We looked at eliminating the required study hall, understanding that not every student fits into the mold that we need to have a study hall. Many students do, and we anticipate that to be the case, but there are also students that do not need a study hall. Having another option as a live course is a good fit for some students. Again, it's not pigeonholing every student to say, you have to have a 45-minute study hall. That will still be a student, but not a requirement. And then the final bullet there is 7 instructional periods, 1 individual plan, and that's removing the PLC plan for the staff. That addresses several different issues that we've addressed previously, but as part of that, does anticipate reduced staffing needs in middle schools because of the number of sections required and the number of staff needed to teach those sections. And so they put in parentheses there, course requests will drive staffing decisions, and that's one of the key tenets of the master schedule building process. As you are fully aware, the district 5-year forecast is certainly a piece of the puzzle here, and that was presented at the board meeting in October by Mrs. Rocker, the 5-year forecast showed a deficit in the 5th year of greater than 10 million. You know, it's a projection, but it is part of planning processes that are needed for the district to stay viable and healthy. We understand that there's renewal levy needs as well as new money needed in coming years. But we are constantly creating analysis of expenditures. That's part of the job, part of the requirements of how we operate as an organization. So that's something that is a piece of what we do on a regular basis. So I mentioned the choir encore classes in sixth grade, health and digital media tech literacy. We're two semester courses for our students in seventh grade, art and PE, as well as the eighth grade design thinking and beautiful design thinking labs. We believe that that is a good opportunity for all of our students to participate in when they're in middle school. And in combination with the Green County Career Center Project Legal Aid courses of automation and robotics, as well as flight and space. And we are very excited about that opportunity because it does meet our career tech responsibilities, and it also is high interest, high motivation for our students in those content areas, and we are looking forward to that partnership with the Career Center. These are elective course offerings. You can see the year long on the left, which includes our music options, our foreign language options, study hall, as well as tutoring for our IEP requirements. And on the semester side of things, you'll see a second opportunity, which would be Project Lead the Way, for a course called App Design and Development. This is really an introduction to coding and app development, which is certainly a very high interest technology offering that is coming our way. Fitness for Life, art, some new courses in interpersonal communication are being developed, as well as language arts electives. They reach the interest needs of those students. We are looking to revise our exploratory language offering to, again, make this a semester course, as well as the development of a learning lab, which should be maybe by invitation or request only, but an opportunity for students to get additional assistance, a chance to get in a almost like an environment as needed. It may be entirely for a semester, it may not be, but it's a learning lab similarly to what the high school does with their language arts portal. Thank you. Always forget that, it's called a portal. But they do that, and we've kind of taken that idea and bringing that down to the middle school level as well. And again, study hall could be an elective course that students would choose to take as well. So our immediate next steps. We need to obviously finalize some items here very, very quickly. The English language arts discussion looking at elective courses and interests for our staff and students. Finalize all of our course offerings so that our program studies will be submitted so that it can be reviewed by December 22nd in preparation for getting to the Board of Education for approval in January. We're going to be also completing from an HR perspective an ongoing licensure analysis for all BCS staff, as well as developing and finalizing registration materials and prepping for February parent meetings, information going out to students for registration, and beginning to get those course requests in by March 1st. So that's what our immediate next steps look like. Now, since we had our staff meetings on Wednesday, obviously this information was shared with our staff. On Monday and Tuesday this week, yesterday and today, I attended kind of a lunch and learning session at CORE yesterday and ME today, where the staff had the opportunity to come in and just ask questions, share concerns. I was there to listen, to share some thoughts, and have some really good conversation and dialogue with our staff about their concerns. And as a 19-year middle school slash junior high veteran, having been through this process twice before in two different districts, I had full understanding of where our staff is coming from and can certainly recognize and understand their concerns. And there are lots of things that we can be doing to help address those things, and that's part of our next steps. The staff at CORE created a series of questions that Mr. Kelly compiled. And as he shared that with me, I took a stab at answering those over the weekend and have shared that back with both Mr. Kelly as well as Mr. Wren for him to share all of that with the staff and share a copy of that as well with all of you so that you were to see what some of those concerns were and how those would have been addressed. Again, we'll be looking at additional elective courses for our art and language art. We started doing that process a little bit when we'll be finishing up here next week or so. And have provided all of this information to our BEA leadership as well as our middle school administrators to share with staff. So it is an effort to be as upfront and as possible with information and timely, as this is the summer, not May. And we have opportunities to help address some concerns that are certainly being voiced in regards to the schedule. So again, the timeline of our master schedule has helped drive the timeline to be able to share this information with all of our staff. I'd like to address just some of what the key themes and concerns were. As staff were reported, PLC times, so losing that is a major change. It's a loss of time for planning collaboration and time with the parents. It does bring with an additional teaching period. with the belief that that includes more students and perhaps more prep periods. What the IEP 504 and IET meeting time can be affected by that, as well as available time to plan student events. So these were, again, voiced concerns to us, both in meetings the past couple days, as well as in written form from last week. Obviously, seeing a slide that says there is a reduction of staffing here, that's going to get the attention, and I certainly understand that. There's fear of job loss, there's fear of not knowing if you're teaching in the same buildings where they currently are, or is that going to require transfer? Timeline of when that information would be shared is obviously a concern. And what is the process for making those staffing decisions? And again, a lot of those have been answered in document and in verbal form to the staff, but those were certainly concerns shared. Looking at encore classes being required versus electives, making courses requirements instead of a true elective was a concern. And what are the impacts of the new courses that are being developed on the traditional offerings that people are used to? That's a concern. And then also staffing, based on the number of elective courses available. And again, as I've said previously, staffing is driven by a course request. And so the number of students that request the course have a direct impact on how many sections are offered and what that means from a staffing standpoint. And certainly equity of teaching responsibilities between buildings. And again, that's a little bit of function of having two buildings of two very different sizes and needs. And what are class sizes in one building versus class sizes in another? And how is the equitability of that? That was important to acknowledge and see what we do to address that, which certainly can be done through some scheduling practices. So next steps. I know that's where we want to make sure we understand what is coming up in the next weeks and months for this process. It is critical, and the first bullet point here, that our building principals and building leadership teams start working on what some of these concerns are. There are a lot of opportunities for brainstorming and collaboration on how to address the working environment in a little bit different, and how to do things a little differently than they haven't done before. Again, it's December, so there's a lot of time to figure out how we can collaboratively come up with some solutions to help solve some of these concerns. Mrs. Murray is working with our special education staff to address their concerns. Mr. Schwederman is going to be going out to buildings in January and be available to meet with the staff if you have questions regarding licensure or their professional development or what kind of courses that they can teach with their licensure. And so that is a planned event that those staff members that have questions about that will be able to have access to the information we provide. The curriculum department is going to continue to collaborate with different content areas, particularly our elective courses that will need to do revision of their content because of a semester course versus a quarter course. We'll be working on that, as well as finalizing a program studies here between now and the 1st of January. We'll continue along our timeline of master schedule building, as we are very committed to that process because it is a timely process and it needs to be completed in certain intervals. We'll continue to do that as the start of the year gets closer. And we plan on, in May, having an update to the board on what the outcome of this master schedule process is and how we can address some of these changes that are anticipated for the schools for next year. And with that, I'd like to turn back over to Mr. Allen, and I appreciate your comments.
Thanks, Jason. One of the pieces that Jason hit on at the end, we're happy that it's December, and one of those comments that we've made is we've kind of laid the foundation of what we see this looking like, but we need the building to be built. So our goal is to collaborate with our teachers, with our staff, to really work through those issues. We were throwing, Jason and I met today with Mr. Schwederman and Mrs. Fiore, and we were throwing ideas out about how do we address some of these concerns. And we have ideas, but at the same time, too, we don't want it to be our idea. We want it to be their idea. We want them to be a part of that process. We want, from where we sit, we see things a certain way. Doesn't mean it's not that way in the building. So really, we want to hear what they have to say, what our staff has to say. And I agree, change is very difficult. We never walk into these jobs wanting to upset the apple cart and make lives difficult. And we know that we've done that with this. But at the same time, too, we know that we see this as a good thing for our kids. We see opportunity as well. But we do acknowledge a lot of those concerns that they have, but those are true and real concerns that we think we'll be able to work through some of those in order to remedy those situations. So hopefully in May, no, I won't say hopefully, in May, we will come back before you and we will not go through that whole presentation. I think what's important is to be able to talk about what do our class sizes look like at the middle school and how are we addressing some of that lost time for our staff that they have used in the past with kids and families. I taught middle school and was a middle school principal myself, so it is a different breed of student at that grade. So we do want to acknowledge that, but at the same time too, we want to work through that. So does the board have any questions?
I don't have a question, but I'll make a comment.
Sure.
This entire discussion this evening obviously concerns me, and it does sadden me. On one hand, I want to applaud Mr. Otten and Mr. Enix, for your hard work and all the time and energy that you put in this. Obviously, the facts and the figures and the data that you presented tonight don't just happen overnight. And I applaud you because this is something that we've kind of inherited based upon negotiations for 15-16. So I'm certain this is not something that you wanted to address out of the chute. It is important to have equity, so I certainly applaud that in what you're trying to do. It saddens me in the fact that I've heard that everybody has said they have middle school experience, and I also have been very fortunate to have spent 13 years as middle school principal and a middle school administrator. And Mr. Otten, you just hit it right on the head. And I don't mean to be disrespectful, but middle school kids are different. They have certain developmental needs that we need to make sure that we're addressing. I am a person that I make a decision, I always ask two questions. My first question is it good for kids? My second question is can we afford it? And obviously, in this situation, I think there are a lot of advantages to what we're proposing. At the same time, I am concerned because I look at all of our jobs is to try to support young people and do what's best for them. And I have a little bit more of an insight, I think, due to the fact that I have been associated with the incredible staff at Hinkley Middle School. I had the pleasure of working with them and seeing the things that they do every single day for kids. And so therefore, I'm one of those people that I kind of take the approach of be broke, don't fix it. And right now, when I see what's happening in our middle school buildings, when I look at the value-added scores, when I see the successes that we're having, when I see the fact that we have, tonight we're going to be approving the statement for November, the forecast, and basically we have a current fund balance of $32 million, even though we do have deficit spending in the office. I say that we need to look carefully at the direction that we're going. And I have complete confidence, I have complete and total confidence with the administration, Mr. Otten, and your leadership, and the staff that is second to none. You'll be able to sit down, and we do have some time. I just don't want to see anybody rush into a decision that we're going to regret in the long run. And I know communication is the key, that is your strength, and I certainly know that that'll happen. Hopefully we can build consensus and make this a win-win for everyone.
What I liked hearing was that you want teacher input. And I think that's really important. I think the collaboration between you. I know just having known you several months, one of the most important things to you is transparency and honesty and openness. And that's why I really appreciate you. And I really appreciate hearing that you want their input. And I like the fact that you started it now and not saying to these teachers in May, this is what's good for you. So I want to thank you for starting this now and opening it up to the teachers. That this is not a shock to them. But the most important thing is I want to thank you for saying we want clear input. I really appreciate hearing that.
Being a little bit close to this issue, having taught middle school for a sixth graders for 31 years, taught in this middle school system for about 15 or 16 years of that. I don't think there's anyone in this room, the administration included, that really does not have the best interest of the kids at the forefront of any decision that we make. And like Benny's mentioned, we are really dealing with a different type of creature. And really, middle school is one of the last opportunities that we have to reach kids before they are set as where they are. It's middle school that is formative, and having taught under the system, PLC system that it was, to have a 17 was an incredible opportunity to reach kids and families and send young people on their way to a better life in many cases. So, again, balanced with the idea of, you know, what's the cost, what is the cost involved with us? As stewards of taxpayer money and stewards of the community perception of their schools and what we do, we have also considered those things as well. So, yes.
I have never taught at Anthony or at any other school. I've taught some courses for the government, but that doesn't count because they weren't involved in children. But I did raise two grandchildren who went through the entire process at Beavercreek schools and graduated and are doing way better than anyone in the world had any reason to expect that they would be able to do after the way they struggled their young life. So I just want to thank all of you for what you do, because it really matters, and for some kids, I think you never realize how it worked out as they became adults. So, you know, I appreciate what you do, and I know that Mr. Otten and Mr. Enix do want to work with all of you on your thoughts and your ideas. Change happens. I've worked 22 years for the federal government, which is scary all by itself. But I can tell you that scheduling that is done right up against any starting project is insanity. I want to applaud both of you for trying to, I have listened to this for years and years about, you know, how frustrating it is for you and the administrators to have so many crisis things happening right in front of school. And this will eliminate one big problem, just getting a hold of the schedule. I'm not talking to, to anything that has to do with academics, but in program management, that is just the biggest disaster ever. And I'm really glad to see you here. We actually like you sometimes. Hard.
Well, I have a middle schooler. I have a sixth grader, Ankeny, and she's had a great start to her middle school experience. So if you can teach me anything, thank you. I mean, I know all of your faces. I know names and emails and things. But this is something that's really important to me, because obviously it's going to affect my kids directly. It's why I think it's important as a parent award. You know, I think we need those perspectives of those who are educators and those who work in the business sector, and those of us who have kids right now in this district, that this matters. And this matters to you as teachers. So thank you for sharing your feedback with us. Please know we've listened to you. Please know we've heard you. You know, we're going to work with, the district is going to work with you to work through those concerns. But, you know, as a parent, I'm glad to see that we're getting ahead of this and trying to focus on what's best for our kids and give them the most choices they can have. Because I see this as a Dell Nelly. My daughter's in her D-Lab class right now. That's all she talks about.
She won't have the opportunity to take next year as a seventh grader.
Yeah, which is awesome. So,
she will not have the opportunity.
She will not?
No.
It's
going to be a required course for eighth graders only. So my heart goes out to those sixth graders that have had a wonderful experience, and now that is a limited choice.
Okay. Well, that's something that, that definitely needs to be looked at then, because those choices are good for our kids. So, yeah, that's something that I know is listed on the list of concerns. So, thank you for what you're doing with them now. I know that they're really enjoying it. So, thank you guys for being here. And we're glad you're passionate about what you do and about it. So, thank you.
Okay. Right, that concludes presentations.
Thank you. I'm March approval of agenda presented, so I move the motion in the second.
Okay.
We have been done that. Are there any discussions? Okay. Please, I'm calling in.
Ms. Marble?
Yes.
Ms. March?
Yes.
Mr. Morrison?
Yes.
Ms. Regano?
Yes.
Mr. Taylor?
Yes.
Okay. Lawrence Board reports, and we are on night tonight. So we're just moving on to, okay, this is the question and comments from the public. And so instead of saying just each one of you is coming up to speak tonight, I'm just going to make a blanket statement that when you come up, please give your name and address. You will have 3 minutes to speak. When you're down to one, this prophet will signal you to let you know. Please know that there won't be any comments from anyone tonight here, but if what you speak about requires an answer, within a week, the appropriate person will get in touch with you. So you need to know that. And with that, the first speaker is Hilda Scheidlin.
Sure.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Sorry, Hilda.
Good evening. My name is Hilda Shirley. I'm a sixth grade English language arts teacher at Coy Middle School. Thank you for listening to me regarding the concerns being made to the middle school schedule. This plan is going to require grade level electives that limit student choice and stifle student interest. It's going to require that teachers will be teaching 7 out of 8 classes a day. These classes will be taught by teachers who are already stretched thin, teachers who already give up countless hours of their personal time to make sure that their kids are getting everything they need both in and outside the classroom. There will be upwards of 200 students walking through our classroom doors on a daily basis. How many of them are going to fall through the cracks? Class sizes will not go down in English language arts classes. Are the class size numbers referred to in the presentation taking into account students that will be moving into the district or the several housing developments that are currently being built? Just the other week at Coy, we had 4 new students in one day. We are also concerned about the accuracy of the numbers used in the plan time study. I am disappointed with the fact that teachers were not part of the laying of this foundation for this very drastic plan. I am disappointed that teachers don't have adequate time to prepare and present a formal presentation, sharing our collective thoughts and feelings regarding this matter, as we were informed of these plans less than a week ago. This is a drastic change, one that has been made before, one that has failed before. This is a change that will have negative effects on our children. I am disappointed that the board will not be voting on this. I respectfully request that you take time to look at how our children in the middle schools will be affected by these drastic changes and to make sure that we as a district have looked at every possible option to prevent this drastic change. And quite frankly, scrapping that plan sounds like a good start. They are, after all, our children, and why we are here. Thank you.
Teresa? Oh, thank you.
daughter currently attends Shaw Elementary, and she'll be coming to Poy next year. She has done nothing but talk about how excited she is to come to Poy and take her mommy's class next year, despite the fact that I told her I am a very hard teacher. I am extremely concerned about the decisions that are being made, because they impact me not only as a teacher, but they impact me as a parent. I am worried about her experience at the middle school. Currently, with our PLC, we're able to talk about our students, we're able to support them, we're able to offer intervention, we can have SAT meetings, we meet with parents, we have special programs, we are able to do fundraisers, go on field trips. There are so many things that we offer our students right now that will be limited without that PLC time. Now, I understand that change is absolutely necessary. I understand that we are facing a deficit, and I understand that we may need to alter the way we currently do things. I can understand that. I absolutely can. But I do think that as we're making those changes, and as you're considering changes when you're new to a district, the people that are here that have been here before should have been talked to. We have done this before at the middle school, and it was awful. Parents were not happy. Kids were not happy. Teachers were not happy. If we needed to make a change, maybe what we need to look at is a way to set aside half of the PLC time. In some way, teachers have to have time to meet with parents. They have to have time to discuss their students. We cannot have teachers teaching two different grade levels. If I'm teaching sixth grade and seventh grade, my sixth grade students don't get to go on field trips. My sixth grade students don't get to do special activities. Right now, we do a workshop once a quarter. The kids look forward to this. The kids who are missing work are getting the opportunity to make that work up, because we want them to learn. We don't want them to fail because they didn't do their work. We want them to have that opportunity. Kids who have done their work, they go to workshops. And students who have work to make up, if they finish it, they get to go to the workshops. And they get to experience the joy of learning. It's more than just math and reading at the middle school. This is the time they learn who they're going to be. And we are a big part of that, but we can't do that if we don't have the time to do it.
Planning time where teachers talk about students, identifying their needs,
providing interventions, meeting with parents, counselors, and administrators to engage in collaborative problem solving. In addition to planning field trips, other grade level character building activities, and collaborative lesson planning. We're not asking for that time back because we know that is a futile request. We are asking that we be given the ability to maintain some semblance of the middle school model that is so necessary for this age group, especially at a time when the state is asking so much of them. We ask that you not continue to force an 8-period day on these young kids. We don't ask that of our high school students. We ask that you not put the school in a position where teachers will have 190 plus students to advocate and provide for. We ask that you would not increase the incidence of poor teachers teaching across late grade levels. We ask that you put middle school students first, and the only solution is a return to a 7-period day and daily advisory, so we have some place to continue to provide these necessary supports for this unique age group and expand the length of time that we have to instruct those students. This new schedule essentially asks our fifth graders to walk into a mini high school, and that is not equitable, and that is not what is best for our students. Thank you.
Takes us on to new business.
feel free to leave. That's not your fault, you guys, but we love you to stay. Just give me the option. And if you need to vote.
With the release of all board members, representatives from standing committees, and approve the following January board meeting date times at the board administration buildings that are closing. January 12th, 2017, the board annual organizational meeting at 6 p.m. Thursday, January 12th, 2017, board's tax budget hearing meeting at 6:15 p.m. And same day, Thursday, January 12th, 2017, board of education regular board meeting at 6:30 p.m. Your motion is second.
Second.
Any discussion on any of these?
August 1st, so if we approve that tonight, which I anticipate we will start communicating that out to our community promptly, because we want to make them aware. Again, it's no changes for next year, but there is a change for the following year. So, and then looking down at item E, which is the release of all board member representatives on standing committee, we will explore that in detail in January, because I know we always have it on the agenda and put some discussion on whether or not we should have all that, if we should maybe reduce some of that for reporting out purposes. So we'll explore that. So that's all I've got on the new business.
Standing district that it is. Also, like to
thank Mr. Otten for the get together on Saturday evening. That was certainly a lot of fun. I really liked the ventriloquist myself. Had fun, and then Merry Christmas to everyone. Yeah.
Mrs. Hyde.
Merry Christmas. Thank you for coming, Charlie. I wanted to feel special.
Thank you.
I did.
To hear it tonight.
No,
I do rest. First of all, I want to thank our administrative team for the work you've been doing every day. I don't think people really understand just what you all do. I mean, they really don't. It's like, oh, you're just a happy bunch here, but you know, but truly from the bottom of my heart, thank you for everything you do, and I know you're always putting kids first. That's what we're all about here, and that's what I love about this team. It's like, it's all I hear is for kids first, for kids first. And this community is very fortunate to have all of you here, all of you. So I want to thank, I really mean this, thank you all for everything you do. I know the work that goes into this as a former teacher. You know, I know, I'm at the other end of it now, I really see what's going on into this. It's a lot of work, it's a lot of work. The other thing I want to do is I want to thank our teachers out there. I mean, I spent part of today in Dallas. I got invited to your Christmas choir concert. And I'm sitting there, and I know I'm an emotional mess, but okay. So I'm sitting there in the audience, and I start crying. And then the teacher next to me starts crying. And then this man, I mean, you know, he starts crying next to me. And I'm like this with the Kleenex. And she's to me, why are you crying? Well, these are my babies. I used to teach here. And so this is emotional for me. And when the teacher started crying, I said, why are you crying? I mean, but you can't help these kids in our district. I'm sure whether it's Beavercreek or Maine or wherever, they're just amazing, amazing kids. Saturday night, and Maine, they had the, it was their choir, all the different
Snow choir.
There you go, thank you. Remember it. And what was so impressive was not just guys and dolls and connections and friends, but then they had the little kids come on stage, their choir, Maine's choir, and they put them all together. That was so impressive because you see, here are the little kids. And then you work across the stage and you see, wow, this is where they can end up someday. I mean, it just touched your heart to see. And these little kids are just so proud of me. I mean, they are singing their little hearts up because, hey, look where I am. I mean, it was just so cool. And last night, Beavercreek High School Band's winter concert, that is amazing. I mean, these bands, they just keep getting, we have band A and B because you can't put them all together because they weren't fit on the stage. So that's just amazing to me too. And I do want everybody to know that this Thursday night is our winter choir concert, and that's at 6:30 at the high school. And we get a jazz, and this is just amazing. Your ears are great fundraiser. I mean, it's just amazing. And if you want tickets, I bought mine last night, but I just want you to know, it's March 2nd, 3rd, and 4th. If you want tickets, and I know they sell out within a matter of weeks. She goes www.weekendofjazz.org and you can purchase your tickets.